My name is Alexey
Kardashevskiy. I live in, I work in IBM Australia with Dr. Paul Makaris on Power KVM project. And today I want to talk about running VFIO on those power boxes he was telling about. Our eventually we want to run VFIO on SRIOV devices, which are really mighty PCI devices where you can have a lot of Ethernet ports, and you can create virtual functions and assign every function to KVM guest, so get maximum performance. Some terminology. VFIO is technology to provide user space access to real PCI hardware. 99% users is PCI pass-through in QEMU, and about the same number is QEMU in KVM mode. Nevertheless, it supports both KVM and fully emulated guests, so VFIO is not about KVM only. It's more about user space. Sometimes people confuse VFIO with VirtIO and IBM VIO. It's not any of those. Next thing I will mention a lot is sPAPR, which is a IBM confidential specification which describes an interface between hypervisor and guest. Currently, P-Series platform and Linux kernel implements this guest part of this specification, and we are trying to replace host part with Power KVM. First implementation of host part of this API was P-Hype, which is IBM proprietary firmware. And this is kind of legacy we have to live with. And IOMMU is a hardware mechanism to map PCI bus addresses to physical memory addresses. It's basically a table where index is a PCI bus address shifted by 3, and content is RAM address. Some more terminology. IOMMU group is a minimal set of PCI functions which can be completely isolated. So we can stop it, disable IO from it. Easiest way to think about it as a pluggable PCI device. Something like Ethernet function, Ethernet card with 4 PCI functions in you know, one device which can you which you can plug in a slot. You can see how platform code assigns devices to groups in CSFS. And we don't normally put different, we don't put functions of the same physical device to different groups because they can talk to each other through some backdoor and access memory, which they shouldn't normally access via DMA. So group is basically PCI device. And the only exception is SRIOV. We trust these devices that they provide enough level of isolation for virtual functions they create and manage. And another thing is VFIO containers, which has nothing to do with Alexey and other types of containers. It's a completely made up thing. The idea is that if you want to access device, read bar, read PCI config space, we open a group, see how many PCI functions are there, get a file descriptor for specific function, and do some operations on it. And container receives DMA map and unmap requests. So that's kind of container for all devices. Since there is a difference between the way x86 does IOMMU and sPAPR does IOMMU. On x86, there is a one PHB on the chip, which is smart enough and can create hardware IOMMU domains. And you can attach multiple IOMMU groups to one domain. So guest gets one domain. On sPAPR, we don't have this stuff. We just have 6 or 7 PHBs on a chip, completely independent, all separated, isolated. In most cases, every PHB has one PCI slot. It has its own IOMMU, which is not shared. So for sPAPR, container always has one group. That's pretty much synonyms. And if you want to pass more than one group to a guest, we pass several containers. Three devices, three containers. PCI support in QEMU. x86 implements some well-known hardware, because on x86, guest is fully virtualized, and it doesn't know that it's virtualized most of the time. On sPAPR, we implement guest part of sPAPR API, which is already there in P-Series platform. All good. And config space interrupts work exactly the same way for devices emulated by QEMU and VFIO. For bars, there are two ways of working with bars. One is map them directly to the guest, and this works exactly the same way for x86 and sPAPR. And emulation, which works, again, the same way. We might want to emulate bars because VFIO works with TCG, which is full emulation, no KVM. So we have to support it. The only worry here is different endianas, because now on PowerPC we support little endian and big endian in both guest and host and all this combination. That's a lot of fun. But it works. We just have to define every boundary, what endianas it uses. Hypercall, PCI config space, bar access, all these things. Except DMA. DMA is very different because we have different IOMMUs. On x86, guest doesn't get to see IOMMU as it's fully virtualized. So what QEMU does, basically maps the entire guest RAM to this, in this domain to PCI address space, and that's it. So the entire guest gets pinned in real RAM. Every single page is in memory. That's because we don't know when and where DMA will happen to, so it must be in RAM. On sPAPR, we have guest visible IOMMU, which means that guest can map and unmap pages on fly by demand. If it needs a lot of them, it calls hypercalls a lot. If not, then not. Hypercalls receive logical IO bus numbers, bus address, guest address, and you can remove them, and you can, there are two hypercalls to pack 512 requests in one to save a little bit on switches from guest to host, vice versa. And another thing is DMA windows. DMA window is an address range on the PCI bus where device is allowed to do DMA. It's called logical IO bus in sPAPR specification, identified by 32-bit value. There is an IOMMU behind every DMA window, which is basically that translation table. By default, every PHB has 32-bit DMA window, which is mapped to first 2 gig of PCI address space. Granularity is 4K pages. And even host system uses these tables. So when we run a guest, we just take control from the host and give it to the guest. And then guest maps guest RAM pages to this window randomly using those hypercalls. A little bit about VFIO drivers. VFIO has, in our case, 3 kernel modules. VFIO PCI module is what we bind devices on the host side, because we don't want host to continue working with this device. There is VFIO module which manages containers and provides user space access to groups. Groups exist without VFIO as well, but there is no way, you know, to access them. And this module provides this capability. And since we have And VFIO PCI and VFIO modules, they do the same thing for x86 and sPAPR. So we don't have to hack them. And VFIO also supports IOMMU drivers because we have different IOMMUs. The default one uses IOMMU API subsystem in the kernel. But we decided not to use that one and fight just one thing at a time. And that thing is VFIO already. So we implement our own sub driver in VFIO 3. And that's pretty much what I did, that driver. So different IOMMUs, they reflect on the way how we run QEMU. On x86, we just had one device with host PCI address, and that's it. On sPAPR, we have to provide, we have to forward DMA window from the host to the guest. And the way it's done, it's DMA window property on PHB in the device tree, which is a mechanism for hypervisor to tell the guest what it has. So there are two ways how to do this. One is introduce our own PHB, yet another PHB type, or implement our own PCI bridge. PHB seems easier, and sPAPR can cope with a lot of PHBs just fine. And I haven't seen any x86 box with multiple PHB ever. Do they exist? Anybody knows? Anyway, from this point, we know that container already has one group, so one-to-one. And container also means a PHB for sPAPR. Okay, that's the way DMA works on sPAPR. Since guest gets to see IOMMU. So normally guest calls DMA alloc. DMA alloc is converted to hypercall. Hypercall switches to KVM real mode with MMU off. Then it switches to virtual mode, enables IOMMU, enables MMU. Then it translates guest physical address to user space address, logical bus number to VFIO container. I'm sorry. And calls ioctl on VFIO container FD. Subdriver in VFIO is called. It translates user space address to host physical address and updates real IOMMU table. There are two things to worry about. One is pin actual page, because now we know that DMA will happen to it, so it must be in RAM. And we have to update locked VM counter, which is that's the counter in the MM struct of current task, which is QEMU, and the counter tells how much memory is pinned. And we test this counter to ulimit. We do this because we don't want user space to pin all the RAM it can. Because if it does it, then the whole system can die. Now, bit of numbers. The fastest card I could get to run tests was 10 gigabit Ethernet card called Chelsea. Top speed 1050 megabytes per second, plus minus 3%. So when we do this, we get 180 megabytes per second. If we use hypercalls, which allow us to pack 212 requests in one, we get a bit better numbers, but still it's 3 times less than maximum. And why is it happening? First main reason that device drivers call DMA alloc a lot, because normally in normal system it would mean something like kmalloc, really cheap operation. And this is not our case. We have to go through QEMU and everything. We also have to switch from real mode to virtual mode to enable MMU. Takes time. and switch virtual mode, user mode, and all the switches, they steal a lot of cycles. So first thing I did, I tried to handle this map and map requests in virtual mode. In addition to what is already done in QEMU, I translate guest physical address to user space address via KVM memory slots, which is quite easy. I translate logical IO bus number to VFIO container, because logical IO bus numbers, they are normally allocated and managed by QEMU, and KVM doesn't get to know what is this, but there is already VFIO KVM device infrastructure, which we can reuse and register IO BNs with specific containers, which is actually IOMMU group. So if I do these simple improvements, I get a lot better numbers. For single requests, it's 750 megabytes per second and 850 for indirect requests. But we want more. We still want 1050. So I tried to use platform API in real mode. And this is what I believe that IBM proprietary firmware does. As its firmware, it can afford running in real mode all the time, not to switch anywhere. So it does it really fast. So we want to do the same. And it's pretty much the same, except pinning actual pages, which is not that easy because in real mode, we cannot use normal page API, like get page, pull page, or get user pages fast, because all these functions, they use two helpers, PFN to page and page to PFN, to find actual page struct. On PowerPC 64, these page structs, they allocated at the boot time by 16 megabytes chunks, and these chunks are not allocated in RAM continuously. There are some gaps. And page struct itself is not aligned. It's not aligned, so we can actually have some page structs which are split between these two 16 megabyte chunks. And if we use, for example, huge pages which have linked lists. So what was done on PowerPC 64, these 16 megabyte chunks were remapped to F bazillion segment continuously. But in real mode, we don't have access to F bazillion address space. We can only access C bazillion address space. And that limits the use of page struct API. And another concern is if page use counter is already zero and we are going to increment it when we map it, we don't do this and switch to virtual mode, because if you do that, then if you try to touch the counter when it's zero, I would expect that page is already scheduled to be swapped out. And when we are mapping and the counter is one, we can trigger swapping again. We better not to touch the page counter in this corner case. So switch to virtual mode again. So when I do all of this, I basically get 1050 megabytes per second, which is kind of real speed of the device. But I have reports saying that when all of this was tried on 40 gigabit Ethernet, performance was almost native first several seconds, and then it becomes something like 1050 megabyte per second. So it doesn't really solve performance issues for really fast devices. It seems that there is kind of design solution in sPAPR spec for this case. sPAPR spec from Power 7, I believe, It allows dynamic DMA windows. So now we can have not just one small window per PHB. We can have more. At the moment, our current hardware supports two tables per PHB. We call one, first one, default one, small one, 32-bit window, and another one is 64-bit window. And the chart says that start address is different, size different, page size adjustable for huge pages, for 64-bit window. And current Linux guests, when they see this capability in the device tree, they basically map the entire guest RAM, starting from half bazillion address once. And if guest is running with huge pages, then they mapped the tables really, really small, like 32 kilobytes for really huge guest. And it doesn't call each call ever again. So it's supposed to solve all our performance issues. But it doesn't. Because the guests cannot explicitly choose window start address because it's hard-coded in the chip. It's either zero or half bazillion. And half bazillion address will only work for real 64-bit devices, and many of them are 48-bit devices, 52-bit devices, so they don't support fully 64-bit addresses on PCI bus. So those devices will still have to use small DMA window and this real mode handler and with all these problems. Just can try implicitly choose address by removing the default DMA window and create new DMA window in hope that it will start from zero address. But current Linux guests just fail if new window starts from zero. We could actually fix it. But also, if we pass several devices, several groups to a guest, we will have several tables, translation tables, and they will all have the same content. And we know that Linux maps entire guest, but we don't know what AIX does. It may still do a lot of requests to map and map pages. And the one issue I mentioned five slides ago, locked memory counter, which we actually should adjust every time we do map and unmap, and we do actual pinning of a page or unpinning. But locked VM counter is not atomic. It's protected by semaphore. We can't use it in real mode, and even in virtual mode, it's adjusted by task, which is basically additional thread, and we cannot create this thread to update locked VM on every map and map operation because we have a lot of them if you do a lot of traffic. So there is a workaround to update the counter when IOMMU stopped being used. By IOMMU, I mean window. Since one virtual PHB can get up to two windows, and one window is 2 gig always, and the second window is huge one. So in the case of 4 gig guest and 3 IOMMU groups, we have to increment the counter up to 80 gigabytes. And when we do that, we allow the guest to pin, to try pinning all 18 gigabytes, which sucks. And I still have no idea how to fix it. Maybe you know. I was told that I should have a conclusion or plan in the end of this thing. That's my plan. Ask opinion how to fix locked VM problem. I keep pushing DDW to QEMU and VFIO. And I need a good piece of advice what to do with this KVM acceleration, because it doesn't support huge pages. and some huge pages. We really want to use them on high performance applications. And a lot of things to discuss. That's pretty much it. Too bad. The only idea I can think of is just add yet another step to VFIO configuration sequence and just force user space to tell KVM, to tell VFIO what memory we are going to use for DMA. And when we start guest, we just tell it that this is the amount of RAM we can possibly use. And then every map on map would basically do would basically update a IOMMU table and not do any pinning or unpinning, or and it will lock at once everything. In the case of that the guest doesn't support huge DMA window, only small DMA window will pin still the entire guest, which is not really cool, but since our motto is to be not worse than x86, and x86 maps the entire guest, we can afford doing the same thing. It should solve the issue.
So we're out of time.
Good.
Thank you.
Thank you.